So here we are, and what we're going to talk about today, actually had more in mind, but I think in light of recent events, there's going to be plenty to talk about with war and peace issues today. And then just to remind you of what we did last time, we talked about animal welfare a bit, and you guys all learned that I'm a vegetarian. And then someone, I don't remember who it was, came up to me afterward and said, "Oh, I'd like to take you out to lunch, and where can we go?" Vegetarians actually can live in the world. It's possible. You know, you can live as a vegetarian. And one of the topics also that I thought we would talk about was biotechnology issues, but I'm just going to skip past that. Other than to say that there's some fascinating issues with regard to biotechnology and the way we're changing our bodies, the way we're changing our genetic structure. I mean, there's some deep and complicated ethical issues there. And maybe for a future class, you know, if we meet again, we could talk about that one. It'd be really worth digging into.
Next semester,
do that with biotechnology. I mean, think of all this stuff. It's about drug enhancements in the Olympic Games and in sports competition. It's about cosmetic enhancements and plastic surgeries. It's about genetic selection of offspring. It's about cloning and all that stuff. A lot of interesting issues there. And with a lot of medical ethics salted throughout. We're not going to talk about that today. we'll think about that. We can think about that for the future. So what we're going to talk about today just exclusively is violence and war and peace. And I'm sure, you know, you guys have been paying closer attention to this probably than I have, because I've been busy with children this last weekend doing some other stuff. But by the way, if we ever hit on anything here and you know more information than me, please stop me and we want to get all the facts right on all this stuff. So, but just to kind of set the stage here, you know, this is from what's been going on in Europe in the past few days, the attacks in Paris, and then now more or less a declaration of war against ISIS, and French planes have been taking off and bombing targets in Syria. The Russians were already there. The Americans were already there. I mean, this is gearing up to be a full-on war here. It's complicated and messy, and it's not going to get better anytime soon. So there's a lot to think about here in terms of the ethics of war. And just to remind you, this is not a new problem. So the ancient Greeks struggled with this. All world civilizations have struggled with the problem of violence and war. In fact, you could even suggest this, that war only exists when you have civilization. So, and here's a brief suggestion about that, is you have to have enough leisure and surplus wealth in order to fight a war, to have a war, right? And that only happens as the result of complicated social structures where we actually have people who can train to be warriors and can build the weapons and then can lead the campaigns and so on. Just think about how much surplus human effort goes into warfare.
To say nothing of money.
And money. Yes, just think about the effort, the energy, the money, the pain and suffering that goes into warfare. For people like me, it's just mind-blowingly baffling because I'm close to the pacifist side of things. So I'm going to try to lay out today, we'll talk about different ways of thinking about this stuff, and I'll tell you a little bit of my own perspective on this. I don't expect that you'll agree with me. Nor did I expect you to become vegetarians after the last one. So, but you know, think it through with me if you please. So, because it's going to get kind of dark here this hour and a half, let's start with kind of a hopeful picture, and I'll try to return with a little hope at the end. This is a passage from Gandhi that I just like, and it kind of can keep our spirits up as we proceed. Gandhi says, "It is my firm belief that it is love that sustains the earth. There only is life where there is love. Life without love is death. Hatred ever kills, love never dies. Such is the vast difference between the two. What is obtained by love is retained for all time. What is obtained by hatred proves a burden in reality, for it increases hatred. The duty of a human being is to diminish hatred and promote love." I think he's right. notice the claim here that what violence and hatred produces is more violence and hatred often. And so, you know, this famous image from Gandhi, you know, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth leaves everyone blind and toothless. You know, his rejoinder to the claim about the lex talionis principles of justice. There's something to this. Gandhi, as you know, is an advocate of nonviolence, a pacifist. But the problem, of course, is Gandhi was killed and other pacifists end up dead. So we have a real big, huge problem in terms of our values here. I mean, probably you all agree to this somehow, right? If you made it this far, chances are you think that love is an important thing in life. And yet the ideal sometimes clashes with reality. You know, so this is the struggle of ethics, is how do we negotiate a world where the reality just doesn't live up to our ideals? What do we do in a broken world? What do we do in a tragic world? Gosh, it's difficult. So let me just, on lines of hope, I don't know if any of you have had a chance to take a look at this book, The Better Angels of Our Nature by Steven Pinker. He's a psychologist, a biologist, a natural science guy, teaches at Harvard. He published this book about 2 or 3 years ago, and in the book, he argues that we're actually making lots of improvement in terms of peace. For example, crime has gone down. We're more civilized. One of the things, maybe a little bit trivial, but he says, we eat with forks now. We don't belch at the table. We learn how to use napkins. I mean, all that stuff is like what he calls the civilizing process. We're more civilized in a sense. And even warfare, as we're thinking of whether this is true or not, but even warfare seems to be a bit more civilized. We have a concept called war crimes, for example, right? That didn't exist in the, you know, previous centuries. There were no war crimes. There was just war. Right? But we actually prosecute people for war crimes. That's progress in a sense, okay? And behind all of this is the spread of democracy. So we'll return to this as we proceed today, but one of the truisms of history is that democracies don't fight each other. Think about it. Can you think of a democratic regime that has ever fought against another democratic regime? Hard to come up with it, right? U.S. and Canada, we get along pretty well, you know? It turns out that war is a political problem of non-democratic regimes who fight against each other, or non-democratic regimes who run into conflict with democratic regimes. So democratic regimes do go to war, but they go to war against non-democratic regimes, right? So Pinker suggests, and he's not the only one, but, you know, we're doing better, in part because democracy is spreading. Not spreading fast enough. you had a comment?
That was a clandestine war, but Mossadegh in Iran in 1950 was democratically elected, and we, with other people, wound up voting him out and installing the Shah. And there's other instances of that in South America. And such.
Yeah, okay.
Unfortunately, with us, it's the aggressor.
Good point. Now, okay, problem worth considering is maybe this is just ideological bullshit. I mean, it could be that it's easy for us to say, you know, we never go to war against other democratic regimes, when in fact we may, when it suits our interests in a way. There's folks that have been very critical of his thesis here. It's a very hopeful thesis, a positive thesis, but then you dig into the question of who's democratic. It's always an interesting question of whether we are in fact democratic ourselves. I mean, the details matter with regard to all this. If you didn't hear what he said in the front, he said, well, how about when the U.S. overthrew the Shah of Iran?
Mossadegh,
and installed the Shah, right? Where there was a democratic election, but it didn't serve our view of the world, so we overthrew the government and installed our own friendly government. You could think of other examples like this, where democracies create regimes we're just not happy with. One clever strategy is we could call them undemocratic. And then go in and fix them, right? Yes?
Another little interesting point, to me at least, you talked about the fact that we have prosecuted people for war crimes, but only the losers.
Yes. Good point. We'll return to this. One reason to want to win a war is so that your side doesn't get accused of committing war crimes, or will be accused but never prosecuted. right? It turns out there's this thing called victor's justice, right? Where the victors get to determine the punishments for the bad guys. It's a big problem. Here's some of my worry on the counter side of this positive thesis is that actually there's violence, but maybe we don't see it, you know? So we have a lot of people in prison here in the United States, you know? A couple million, 3 million people in prison in the United States. That's a kind of violence because after all, we're violating their rights and so on. It leaves the rest of us safer, but it also causes violence in communities where prisons disrupt the ordinary lives of people and so on. And then this worry I have, which is that there's something broken in our culture. We seem to have a very violent culture. Yes. It's the rap music, the heavy metal music. I sound like a real old fart right now. It's the rap and the heavy metal and the video games, you know? But it is. I watch what my kids, my teenage kids, do and listen to and so on. That didn't exist when I was a teenager. There were a few kind of scary movies and there was Rambo and whatever, you know, but there weren't these first-person shooter games that they spend hours online playing. Mm-hmm. I'm worried about that. Or maybe it's not so bad. Maybe they go online instead of actually killing people. Maybe that's a solution. And then the problem of mass murder, which are these people that walk into schools and employment places and whatever and kill strangers. That's a problem. That's a symptom of a dysfunction, I think, in our society. There's something wrong there. So we'll talk about some of the stuff that's wrong. But the hopeful idea is most of us are not like that. I think to try to think about hope, you know, we want to think about the great majority of people who actually agree with Gandhi. There's a lot of people who will say, yes, love is the solution, and we need to spread that around the globe. So this is an image that came out of Paris recently. You know, this is the Eiffel Tower turned into a peace sign, and this is solidarity here. And I mean, the horrors of what transpired in Paris, and then the next day, people are building each other up. You know, so if there's going to be hope, it's in that building up process. And we still have to think about the ethics of the tearing down process. So I'm at the end of my term as the president of Concerned Philosophers for Peace, which is a national organization. And they had their conference in Baltimore 3 or 4 weeks ago. And so I gave the presidential address where I criticized what I called thug culture. Baltimore is an interesting place to talk about violence.
No kidding.
In light of what's happened there in the past year. So actually that conference focused a lot on that kind of violence, on police violence and dysfunctional violence within neighborhoods and within the world and so on. My point, the talk that I gave there was to point out that there are thugs everywhere. This is the person who shot up Virginia Tech, if you remember Virginia Tech. This is the guy that shot up the church, the African-American church in, was it South Carolina? Yeah. And then this is supposed Jihadi John who went and engaged in some of the beheading for ISIS. Okay? Christopher Mercer is the guy that shot up the college in Oregon about a month ago. Okay? One of the interesting things about all this, and these are just like, you know, archetypes in our history. These two guys, Harris and Klebold, do you know who they are?
Yeah.
The Columbine murderers. Interesting problem is that people like these guys looked back at the examples of previous mass murder and wanted to copy it and emulate it. So Klebold and Harris especially were sort of turned into heroes, the heroes of the murderous fringe, as it were. And when these folks dig into online environments where these murderers exchange ideas, Klebold and Harris come out as like paradigms that they would like to model themselves on. They also listen to heavy metal and rap music. Part of my talk in Baltimore was about the strains of heavy metal and rap music that go into fueling some of this. Most important feature of all of this is they're all young males.
Yes. Yes.
We don't see young women going into schools and killing strangers. So there's something, in my mind, dysfunctional and broken in masculinity yes. in our culture.
Couldn't be.
You don't think so? And I think this is not just today, but it goes all the way back to the ancient world where to be a man was basically to kill someone. If you think about the heroes of our civilization, Achilles, Odysseus, and so on, the great warrior heroes, we have this myth that glorifies the warrior. And so young men arrive on the scene, they have access to guns, they're fueled by testosterone, and they have bad judgment. And next thing you know, they're walking into a movie theater or a school and killing strangers. Something broken here, I think. One way of describing this or accounting for this is to use a concept called cultural violence. Johann Galtung is, did I speak with him, with you about Johann Galtung before? He's a Norwegian social scientist, philosopher type, who basically created or discovered or described this idea of structural violence, which you may have run into somewhere. Structural, you know what direct violence is? This is when someone kills someone or beats someone, okay? Structural violence is when the social conditions, through no one's direct violent intention, nonetheless, those social conditions produce violence. So, like structural racism is part of the structural violence matrix. When violence happens as a result of structural features, not with anyone's direct intention, but just as the result of the social setting. Galtung has also described and talked about what's called cultural violence. And so this event that I mentioned, the Concerned Philosophers for Peace, we talked about cultural violence. And the way Galtung describes cultural violence is he says, in a violent culture, or a culture of violence, violence comes to look, even feel right, or at least not wrong. Mm-hmm. Now think about those schoolroom shooters, right? At the very least, they think what they're doing is not wrong. Probably. Or maybe they're just evil and they want to do evil for evil's sake. But there's some kind of permission in our culture such that violence just doesn't feel as wrong as it probably should. Back to the video games, mm-hmm. right? Imagine you spend hours in your room shooting at pictures of people on a screen. You condition yourself, I think, to maybe think that that's not as wrong as you actually ought to think it is. Now, there's a lot of literature here. If you saw my Fresno Bee article last weekend, I talked about some of that literature. Yeah, sad irony. There's a lot of literature that actually shows that there is some correlation between cultural images of violence and real violence. Difficult question about how much it exactly is causally related, because as you know, there's lots of kids, my own, who listen to violence, see violence, and they don't do anything violent, right? So to say there's a direct causal story there is a little bit too much. But Galtung's approach is clever. It's not that cultural violence causes you to do violence, rather it permits you to do violence, because you learn to see that violence is not as wrong as you might have thought it was. You follow that little twist of an argument? Another hint about this. There's a guy, former military guy, wrote a book called On Killing, David Grossman. And in that book, he explains how the military teaches people to kill. They have to do that, in case you didn't realize, right? Most people don't want to kill. And in fact, there's some history about this, that in previous wars, people would aim around and above, and you know their gun would accidentally get jammed, and they just didn't want to shoot, right? So the military had to find ways to actually increase the kill rate, right? To teach people how to be better at the act of killing. And it's through cultural stuff, right? Old school, you sing songs and chant songs about how much you want to go and kill the enemy. Anyone been through that in boot camp? You know how that works. New school version is you can actually use simulations, virtual reality simulations, to overcome the threshold of resistance that people might have psychologically to the act of killing. Grossman points out, he says, the military knows how to do this. And in fact, we're doing that to our own children because some of the same techniques, right? You just get people used to it and it becomes a little bit easier. There's a lot more to be said there, controversial stuff to say the least. I'm not going to read all this to you, but if you're interested, my Fresno Bee article last Saturday was about this stuff. And one of the things that I think is that we don't get is that young men like to blow stuff up. I was one myself. There's something about guns and bombs that are just cool and fascinating, right? But most of us grow out of it. The normal trajectory is to grow out of it and to realize that there's something wrong about that. Some people don't grow out of it. That's the problem, right? Interesting question. Should we grow out of that? You know?
Yes.
I think we should grow out of it. Second point that I made in that piece is that violence just doesn't work. If we're having an argument about something and I kill you, I haven't won the argument. I haven't, right? I mean, you're gone. You were never convinced. I had to kill you, right? That does nothing at the realm of moral discourse, of rational inquiry. It's useless in a sense. Now we understand why it happens, right? You get frustrated and fed up, or you have to actually oppose someone who is causing violence to someone else, and we'll get there in a minute. Violence, you know, used in self-defense and as a response to violence and so on. But even violence used in self-defense doesn't win an argument. It stops the argument, but there's no one who's actually come out ahead. The truth doesn't come out through violence. You don't see scientists killing each other over scientific disputes. You don't see philosophers doing that. There's something about violence that is just not adequate to the task of creating moral communities, creating ethical discourse, of lifting us up. Violence just doesn't do that. Yes?
I think one of the reasons that violence is pervasive is that there are many families in which children grow up in violence, and they grow up being punished by parents, physically punished by parents. They grow up having to contain anger that they feel toward the parent because they don't dare hit back at the parent. So all of that just fuels building and building anger, and it builds to what we have today in young men, I think.
So she points out that in violent households, people learn to be violent. So when children are treated violently by their parents, they internalize it, they become angry. Their models are violent, so they learn that that's appropriate, or at least not wrong, as Galtung would put it. There's some data that backs this up, that most bullies have themselves been bullied. You probably know this, right? And what happens is, you learn that that's the way the world operates, right? Oh, that's what we do! We bully, we push around, we behave violently. Yes?
But in the previous generations, families hit the children were hit with sticks. They were less violent, those children, than the children of our permissive parents now.
Yeah, interesting. Well, okay, now, love that comment. Are we more or less violent today? Steven Pinker, remember? He says we're actually better. But now we have schoolroom shooters. I mean, we have like these spectacular levels of violence. I mean, it's an interesting question about whether we're better or worse. Probably this, more of the same, would be my guess. It's human nature after all. I mean, how much can human nature really change? But spanking of children in previous generations, right? How does that relate to all kinds of other cultural problems? Male dominance in families, right? Child abuse, child sexual abuse, and so on and so forth. I mean, it's a bunch of interesting questions here that we really need to dig into, and we need some social science to figure out the truth of all this. This point is easier for me to make, the philosophical point, which is that violence does not solve the question of truth. Violence does not promote rational discourse. Violence does not lead us to the conclusion of an argument. For a philosopher, that's all that matters, because all we want to do as philosophers is argue, right? And the minute you are violent or I'm violent, the argument's done. The debate is over. We're no longer deliberating. We've moved out of the sphere of rationality into some other realm. So I argue there we need education. And then this point that my wife said, is that really true? That more people are killed in car accidents than are murdered by strangers, and it's true.
Oh, yeah.
Trust me on that. Car accidents, like 40,000 people a year in the United States are killed by car accident. And the mass murderers, as bad as they are, and they seem to be more because the mass murderers model on each other, still it's a matter of tens and dozens here and there every so often. It's not 40,000 people a year who are being killed. Yes?
Car accidents have come way down. They used to be about 50,000 a year in the United States. Now they're down to about 20,000.
20,000. We're making progress in that direction.
How much safer cars and safer roads?
Safer cars, seatbelts. Still insane drivers, though.
Yeah.
Better cars. Yeah. What, you know, yeah, we'll put Google. You know, one of the interesting factoids in all of this discussion is because the survival rate of murder attempts is also increased because we have better medicine. We have better medicine, right? Also true with battlefield casualties. There are fewer deaths because we have better medicine, which is really not a solution, if you think about it, right? It's worth thinking about. So anyway, this was my conclusion. Turn off the TV, find ways to channel youthful aggression, and keep guns away from madmen. We also ought to teach our children that there are reasons for hope, even in the face of senseless atrocity. I'll stand by that one. The gun control issue, I just have no idea about that. It's complicated, to say the least, especially in a culture like ours where guns are ubiquitous. How are we going to manage that? I have no idea. But here's one thought I've had about this. We need more metal detectors in places. Why is no one proposing that? You go to Israel, to get into a university campus in Israel, you have to walk through a metal detector. Why don't we have that here? Some entrepreneur who runs a metal detector business should sell that way. They make a lot of money, put in more metal detectors. Okay, so back to Paris. You know the statistics, you've been watching this in the news. And you know, it could have been worse, actually, if you think this. I mean, it's as horrifying as it is, it could have been worse. And then, of course, the world responded with solidarity to the events. The president of Paris then declared war. He said that France was at war. The attacks in Paris represented an aggression against our country, against our values, against its youth, and against our way of life. And then Europe has been rallying behind this. The United States seems to be on the fence. Although we've expressed solidarity with the French people, I'm not sure that we're yet willing to go to war at their side. Although, as I'll show you in a minute, we've already been at war against ISIS. We're just not calling it what it is. Interesting problem in all of these conversations. There's a lot of double talk. There's a lot of we say this and do that. There's a lot of ideology and euphemism. Euphemism is a nice sounding word for something awful, right? The political discourse around war is so fascinating to watch, right? We wave flags and talk about heroic stuff over here, and then we do something else over here. Politicians are caught in a very interesting dynamic when it comes to thinking and talking about war. Imagine this. I mean, frankly, what else could the president of France say at that moment? Could he have gone Gandhi?
No. Gone Gandhi.
He couldn't have articulated the Gandhi perspective. There's something about the dynamics of political power that are such that war is almost, you know, more than not the conclusion of the argument, right? Especially when there's violence at hand. What else could a president say other than now we're at war and let's go in and kick their asses? So in terms of thinking about war, and you know this because you've witnessed this in your own lives, there are wonderful, amazing, heroic things that we celebrate about warriors, and then there are dastardly evils that we regret. War is one of those things. It's like life itself. It is convoluted and complicated in terms of our value judgments here. We don't want to lose track of either part of the discussion. So you have to be careful, I think, talking about war, because some people want to only focus on the atrocities, and some people only want to focus on the heroism. And in both cases, we miss the entirety of the argument, right? It is complicated, to say the least. It's a historical event. The context and the meaning changes over time. It involves massive numbers of people who each have their own interest in games that they're playing and their own concerns and their own intentions. How could we ever come up with a moral judgment about something as complicated as this?
Well, I think you did a pretty good job in saying violence doesn't answer the question.
I like that conclusion too. But I'm trying to point out it's a lot more complicated than that. Yes.
Yes, this is a very different kind of war. It's not like World War I or World War II. This is a whole new set of new problems
that yes.
we don't know how, the civilized countries don't know how to deal with.
Yeah, no, she points out, in a sense, each war is unique, right? But the problem of the war on terrorism, broadly construed, is that terrorists kind of come and go and infiltrate bits and pieces of ordinary life, right? It's different than, say, when the Japanese attack Pearl Harbor, right? There's something different about this. Of course, the responses have also been equally difficult. Drone attacks behind the lines that blow up people in their own homes are strangely like terrorist attacks, right? But this is the problem of the war on terrorism, is there are no clear battlefields. The battlefield is everywhere. The guys flying those drones live in Las Vegas, right? They go home at night to their wives. That's very strange, you know? It's a new war. Or maybe it's just the same old thing, which is human beings killing each other yet again, right? In the back, yes?
We're pretty fickle-minded. In the war against the Communist, the Taliban were freedom fighters for us.
Right.
That was called the Wilson War. But now they're terrorists.
Yes.
Osama bin Laden was our ally.
Problem. Alliances and allegiances change like that overnight, right? And the names we use to describe different players change also, right? At one point it's your freedom fighter, at the next point it's a terrorist, and so on. It's a difficult game. How can we make any sense of it, you know? Especially given the fact that each day there's a new threat and a new set of weapons and so on. Boy, this is a difficult challenge for moral philosophers. Let's pause for a second. I just want to get this out on the table, that when we're talking about the morality of war, we're only partially talking about what soldiers do. Sometimes soldiers can do immoral things within a war. Soldiers can violate the rules of war. But war itself, no soldier decides. We decide. We the people decide. The politicians decide, right? When soldiers go to fight in wars, they do it on our behalf because we send them, we pay the tax dollars that support them, we elect the people that send them, right? So most of what we're talking about with regard to the morality of war is not really about the soldiers. They just carry out the actions, the intentions, the behavior of war. And my conclusion, I'll jump to the end. I'm going to share this with you when we get to the end, is the answer to all of this is more and better democracy. You know, we need to talk better about this, think better about this, vote better about this, hold our elected leaders more responsible about this. War is a political act, not the act of any individual soldier. These are some of our cadets here on campus, by the way. We have ROTC. I've had students who have come through with gotten philosophy degrees and then gone and been commissioned as officers, and I value them. And I would never want to say something about them that is disrespectful towards them, even though I'm mostly opposed to war. You know, we live in a culture that has a military. It's part of who we are and what we do. Okay, moral continuum for thinking about this stuff. Pacifism, is this right, left and right? Yeah, I think I got it right. Okay. Pacifism over here on the left. The hardcore pacifist says war is never, ever justified, period, the end. Pacifists can also say violence is never justified, period, the end, including maybe even violence to animals. I mean, how deep does pacifism go? How much violence are we talking about? At the very least, as a theory about war, pacifism says war is never justified. But interesting question, what about police? Can a pacifist allow for police action? How deep does it go? Interesting question, okay? Again, the claim that war is never justified is kind of an absolute claim, far on the left. Even Gandhi apparently said, well, in some circumstances, maybe it's possible to imagine, you know. Very few absolute pacifists. On the other side, on the right, I guess, are the realists who will say that basically the world consists of war, the political world, historical world, there is war. Our job in that world is to win. And in order to win, we do whatever it takes to win. There are no moral constraints in war from this point of view. There are prudential concerns, strategic concerns. You want to make sure you win. But morality doesn't really apply in the context of war. Okay? Two radically opposed views. In the middle is what I believe this is the mainstream in the United States. In fact, I've gone to military ethics conferences, and I've been on panels with guys in uniform, and almost all of them are in this middle here, what's called the just war tradition, which claims that war can be justified as a last resort, but it should be limited, and there are moral constraints that apply even within war. That's the just war idea. Okay? You've heard of this before? Okay, so what we'll do is kind of work our way through each of these and fill in some details in a moment. So let's talk a bit more about ISIS, if you care to. You want to talk more about ISIS? Okay, we have to. New York Times has a couple of interesting graphics that show basically what's been going on with ISIS. It's worth, if you're interested, you could pursue this, New York Times. This shows where ISIS has been active. Countries outlined are where ISIS is conducting regular military operations. Then there's bits and pieces of attacks. These over here, these were like individuals that got inspired by some ISIS ideology and then went off and shot up a recruiting station, military recruiting station in Tennessee, if you remember that one, about a year ago. The young man at UC Merced last week, apparently there was some ISIS something, maybe. That was kind of vague, and no one ever, as far as I know, no one followed up on that. But then certainly, as you know, this is all kind of evolved and developed here between the border of Syria and Iraq, where ISIS actually holds territory and has declared themselves to have a sovereign nation there. Okay? Now, how much time do we have to figure out how this transpired? So we'd have to back up through the war in Iraq under George W. Bush, and then when Obama finally, you know, pulled the troops out and so on. We'd have to back that up probably before George W. Bush, back to the first Gulf War, the 1990s, which was Iraq, you can't see it here, but Iraq and Kuwait. I mean, that's early 1990s. And to really figure all that out, you might have to back it all the way up to, I don't know, 1945 or 1917. The history of the Middle East is convoluted and complicated. Let's not go into all that history unless you really want to. But back to the present moment. So now you know, right, the Russians have started bombing in Syria. The French, as of Saturday, started bombing in Syria. Americans have already been actively engaged with the ISIS enemy. I'll show you a moment here. We've killed 20 plus thousand ISIS soldiers. Americans have killed 20 plus ISIS soldiers in the last couple years. These are, again, New York Times, these are the attacks so far in the past year, basically. This is the Charlie, where's Charlie Hebdo? Charlie Hebdo in Paris. back in January, if you remember this, the terrorists went in and shot up the satirical magazine, Charlie Hebdo. Here is the Russian plane that was bombed about a week or two ago, right? And then here's the Paris attacks. This altogether adds up to about 1,000 civilians killed by ISIS terrorists basically within the past year, okay? The pacifists are gonna have a hard time thinking about this, right? I mean, at some point, and it seems to be increasing maybe, but at some point it seems like you gotta do something. Back to President Hollande and the Russians and the rest of it. At some point you gotta do something because it just seems to be keeping happening. ISIS claims that these are all their allied countries, okay? Whether that's true or not is an interesting problem. And there are other groups running around, right? The Boko Haram group in Nigeria, you know about that, which actually is has one of the worst records of atrocity, yeah. Right? Al-Qaeda, the Taliban in Afghanistan, and so on, right? If you've been awake for the past 10 years, you've probably been hearing about all this stuff. So here then is what the US has already been engaged in, even though, as far as I can tell, there's no really declared war here. But an article published last month in The Atlantic claims that 20,000 ISIS fighters have been killed by American forces in the past year or so. So it said this week, back in October, Pentagon official anonymously told USA Today that the US-led air campaign against ISIS had killed 20,000 of the group's fighters in just over a year. That figure was up from July, when military intelligence estimates suggested that 15,000 members of the Islamic State had been killed. Interesting question if you pursue the numbers here. How many people do they have? I got that in a minute. So there's one interesting question in terms of the ethics of war. Who can be killed? The ISIS fighters, we probably think they're legitimate targets, but what about their wives and children and family and other innocent folks who live in those towns and villages? Interesting problem, we'll return to that. One suggestion is when you pursue these numbers is that they are recruiting, right? So even though some are being killed in Syria and Iraq, others are flowing in from other parts of the world, right? If you kill 20,000 a year, I mean, how long does this go on? It's an interesting question. Then you also wonder, are these numbers legitimate? How do we know? Isn't it in the interest of American military folks to say, we've killed 20,000 of them. Maybe we haven't killed that many, or maybe we've killed more. Think about how this works, how these numbers come out and are thrown around, and whose interests are being served by what. So here's the civilians killed by American air campaigns against ISIS. This estimates 450 civilians have been killed by American air campaigns. More than 5,700 airstrikes have been launched within the past year, basically. This is from August. That's a lot of airstrikes. Right, and some civilians have been caught up. Again, with regard to this number, how do we know? How do we know what the number is? And in order to pursue that, let me back you up, I'm sorry, back into that history real quick. This is the war on terrorism. Wikipedia has been keeping a tally. There's other people, places that keep tallies. These are Americans killed in the war on terrorism. Where are we? US military, over 6,000 US military killed, 50,000 American soldiers wounded. This is in Iraq, Afghanistan, and elsewhere where American soldiers are fighting. US civilians killed, more than 3,000, including 9/11. They put the total number of Americans killed at close to 10,000 then. Total Americans wounded, 56,000. This is serious stuff, right? And we're in the middle of it. On the other side, the difficulty of calculating these numbers, I've been paying attention to this. I mean, this is actually one of my research areas. I've been writing and talking about war and peace for quite a while. Trying to figure out the numbers of casualties in Iraq and Afghanistan is very difficult. Partly, Americans don't want to do the body count, right? We don't really want to know. And yet we do. Certainly the military should want to know, right? Because it's in their interest to know if their bombs are working and so on. So notice the broad range here in Iraq, from 60,000 to 1.1 million. That's such a broad range as to be almost meaningless, frankly, if you think about that, right? From 60,000 to over a million. The Iraq Body Count Project, which basically their methodology, if you know anything about this, they in order to count as a death, it has to be reported in two media sources. So it's only the deaths that are published and confirmed through media sources. And they put the minimum number at 60,000 civilians killed in Iraq. Yeah.
In that previous slide, I'm wondering, did they give the sources of their data? Because I am very distrustful of Wikipedia when it comes to anything controversial.
Yeah. To draw any conclusion, you got to go in and dig through and sift through the data and look at what sources they're quoting. I believe this number, though, the military number, is legit. American soldiers killed. Someone could actually, if you have an iPad here, you can go in and click and find out. But something around 6,000 American soldiers killed, I think that's about right. 3,000 at 9/11, that's about right, right? This much higher number, I don't know. Afghanistan, look at the range here, from 10,000 to 250,000, right? Let's take the low end range on both of those, though, right? So we got 60,000 and 10,000. We're talking 70,000 plus civilians killed in Afghanistan and Iraq. Now pause for a second. I saw your hand. Pause for 1 second. The ethical question in war is about who killed them. So we got to be really careful when we throw the numbers out there. If you remember what was happening in Iraq, there was sectarian violence. I mean, once the initial shock and awe was over, then Iraqis were killing other Iraqis, right? In Afghanistan, similar problem, right? How much of this is our responsibility, and how much of it is not our responsibility? Interesting question. Some will say, because we went in and invaded, it's all our responsibility. We're responsible for all of it. Or maybe not. And notice, by the way, our moral judgments about this may change over time. Maybe in the initial invasion phase, we're responsible, and then later, as time moves on, we're not as responsible? It's an interesting question. Yes?
This is not a game where we see who scores most. And it's treating it like a game. The guy, we killed five times more than you guys, therefore we win. It just annoys the hell out of me. I remember body counts in Vietnam. It was awful. And the other thing that I would wonder is it possible to win a war against a philosophy? You bomb them, you shoot them, does not change their mind.
Yes. No, the second point, come back to the first one. The problem is, right, that ideology gets fueled by violence that's thrown against it, because now the backs are against the wall. And how do you change people's minds? That's a tough question. How do you change people's minds? I mean, beneath all of this, frankly, I mean, beneath all of this is politics, religion, psychology, culture, sociology, history, philosophy, ethics. I mean, this goes deep. How do we fix it? Back to the numbers game, right? So, interesting question about any of these numbers. Are they good or bad? Are they better or worse? Right? Second World War. Tens of millions are killed. This is nothing. This is a blip in comparison to the Second World War, right? Of course, if you're one of the one, if you're one of the numbers, that's all you got, you know? The question about whether the numbers count and how they count and to what extent they count, that then backs us up into some moral questions about how we evaluate all this. The American number of soldiers killed in the past 15 years, 6,000. In comparison to Vietnam, nothing. It's a blip. Right? Unless, of course, you're one of those soldiers, or his wife or mother. The moral judgment is complicated on all of this. Syria, here's what's been going on in Syria. New York Times in September, 200,000 dead. Again, interesting question about who's to blame for this, who's responsible. And as best the New York Times suggests that 181 civilians have been killed by American-led airstrikes. We might say, pretty good, only 181 killed. Or we might say, oh my God, horrible atrocity, right? Moral judgment about that is complicated. Last bit on what else is going on in other places, Yemen and Pakistan, the drone war that's been ongoing, right? So this is a drone casualty bureau. They've been keeping track of drone casualties. Again, the numbers may be good or bad, depending on the moral framework. Maybe the good thing about drone warfare is we're killing bad guys without putting our own troops at risk. And since they're targeted and precise, we're minimizing civilian casualties along the way. Maybe it's good. Or maybe it's bad because nonetheless, we still end up with civilians and children who are killed even by these supposed smart weapons. Right? Yes?
A recent article in the New York Times regarding the pilots of the drones and severe mental illness problems because they're not as precise as we would wish.
Yeah, I mean, that just points towards this other question of PTSD and psychological issues and the difficulty of fighting in any war. The idea that somehow a drone pilot would be immune to the effects of knowing that you've killed someone, that's preposterous, right? Human beings, if you know that you're responsible for killing someone, it's going to affect you somehow. Now, interesting point about PTSD, which is worth considering. If killing can be morally justified, then the moral harm that's caused by killing might be fixable, right? One story you could tell yourself if you've ever been confronted with the need to kill someone is that you did it for the right reason. It was justified, right? Imagine how damaging it is to believe that whatever you've done is not moral. That's a whole nother level of psychological and moral harm. Okay, back to our, enough with the numbers, back to our moral continuum. What would the pacifists say about all of this? Let me skip all this. Oh, we'll start with realists. What would the realists say about all of this? The realists would say, so what? As long as we win. Part of the problem is, of course, we haven't seemed to have won. The realist doesn't really care about the numbers. The realist wants to know that we have won. The point of war is to win, after all, if you're a realist. Why is it called realism? Because the claim is made that reality requires war, and reality requires victory. If we're going to go to war, we better damn well win, and we better do whatever it takes to win. Morality, on this view, morality and moral limits get in the way of victory. Understand that point? Right? If we're worried about killing a few innocent civilians, we're not going to do what it takes to win, says the realist. Okay? You may have heard some of these people, we should bomb them back to the Stone Age. Let's nuke them. Who cares how many die? But we'd win. And by the way, the war would be over. Let me give you a little harder, firmer argument on this side. The war against Japan and Germany, how long did it last?
4 years,
6 years, 1939, 1941, depending on how 4 to 6 years, the Second World War lasts, right? How many millions are killed? Tens of millions are killed. War is over. We bomb the snot out of Germany and Japan. We drop atomic weapons on Japan. Guess who our best friends in the world are? Germany and Japan. The realist says that's the lesson of history. You win decisively, you win quickly, you dismantle their political system, you take apart their religion, you rebuild their culture and civilization in your own image, and from there on out, now you have allies and friends. Do you understand? That's the realist view. It's hard, especially if you've been to places like Hiroshima and seen what that looks like. This is a famous quote from Thucydides: "The strong do what they have the power to do, and the weak accept what they have to accept." That's the reality of the world from the realist standpoint. I'm not going to read that. That's General Sherman marching to the sea and burning Atlanta. The famous claim Sherman makes that war is cruelty, and we do what it takes in order to win. Now, that's the right. The pacifist says, "Oh my God," about that, and usually they're religious, so that phrase actually fits. The pacifist will say about the realist that that is just blatantly, obviously immoral. And in fact, the pacifist says that all war is immoral. Violence is immoral. Killing is immoral. One root of this, rival interpretations of who Jesus is and what his message was, but many pacifists will trace their ideas back to a version of early Christianity and say that Jesus was advocating pacifism. And the best passage to find this is in the Beatitudes: "Blessed are the peacemakers," and the word there, the Latin word pacifici, pacifist. Blessed are the pacifists, right? This whole thing, this passage: "Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you, to him who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also." This is a version of pacifism. From the realist point of view, this is stupid, insane, and maybe even evil. Let me fill that in, right? Enemies want to kill you, and not just you, but your children and your friends. The realist says you have an obligation to take care of you and yours. This, loving enemies, is a recipe for death, says the realist. The pacifist says, this is the higher path, right? The realist wants to say this is a recipe for death, but the realist's approach is a death recipe also. Because what does the realist want to do but kill as many people as they can? Huge impasse between these two points of view. You can see, realists and pacifists can't be married. They can't sit at the dinner table together. These are deep, deep divides here, this divide. Tolstoy, Gandhi, etc. Martin Luther King is in this tradition. Let me just point out one thing about pacifism. People get confused. It's not passive-ism. It's not about being passive and doing nothing. Gandhi, King, and others have showed that actually you can be committed to peace and committed to nonviolent and very active in your energy and how you want to change the world. So the word here is active nonviolence, right? The realist will say, "What are you going to do, nothing, Mr. Pacifist?" And the pacifist will say, "I'm going to do lots of things. I'm just going to do nonviolent things." There's maybe, the pacifist says, there's lots of nonviolent ways to fix this stuff. The realist laughs, "Ha! Your nonviolent activism will do nothing to eliminate pernicious ideologies and evil in the world," and so on, and so it goes. And then, of course, the problem for pacifists is that they might end up dead, right? Now, one offering here about why some people will advocate pacifism is, for some people, death is not the end of things. So it's not by accident that many of the committed pacifists have also been religious, right? There's an idea that there's a bigger picture than just this world, and death is one small stage in a much larger story, right? King certainly thought such, you know, when he makes these claims that unearned suffering is redemptive. He'll be redeemed in the next world, ultimately, right? This drives some people nuts. So there's this guy, Derek Jensen. He's an anarchist from Oregon. He wrote this book, Endgame, which is interesting and worth reading, where he calls out the pacifists and he says, "You pacifists are idiots. You have a death wish. You're insane. You're evil. You're immoral. You're deluded. You don't understand the world." And so it goes. Okay? Now, in the middle, the just war tradition says the realist is wrong because there are some limits in war. Morality can be applied to war, says the just war theorist. And the pacifist is wrong, says the just war theorist, because in some cases, you have to fight. It would be immoral not to fight, like to defend your children. Okay? The just war tradition in the middle. The story of the history of the just war tradition, it develops out of early Christian pacifism, and eventually when the Roman Empire becomes Christian or Christians gain political power, now they got to find a way to fight wars. Okay? So they have to search around for justifications. The most, this one's often quoted, Paul in his letter to the Romans, he basically says in the letter to the Romans that the sovereign uses force or violence in order to enact God's judgment. Unlike Christ with the turn the other cheek, right? Here it is that the sword can be used to exact justice, okay? So by the time we get to Augustine in the Middle Ages, now this idea that Christians could fight a war and that it could be morally just gets developed. This goes through 1,000 years of discussion. through the Middle Ages, Augustine, Thomas Aquinas, and others. We get to the modern period. There are a lot of scholars and theologians who are thinking about it. By the time we get to the last part of the 20th century, this is pretty much codified into two big ways of thinking about the justification of war. The first one is called jus ad bellum. This means justice in going to war. Justice in going to war. In order to be justified in going to war, you have to have a just cause. You have to have the legitimate authority. War has to be proportional. It has to be a last resort, and you have to have the right intention. There are other bits and pieces that are woven into this, but the idea is something like this. When someone attacks you, aggresses against you, you have a right to defend yourself. If you're authorized to do that defending, it's your obligation to do the defending. President Hollande, right? You should go to war trying to fix what was broken, which means that there are limits in terms of what's proportional, right? A minor incursion can't then lead to a nuclear conflagration. That would be disproportional, right? You should try nonviolent things until it's obvious that they don't work, and your intention should be righteous, not a pirate. Pirates go to war for the wrong intention. They want the stuff, right? Here, the right intention is to defend the innocent, to defend your borders, and so on. Okay? Classic example, this is, you know, Japan attacks Pearl Harbor. Most people say that's an obvious just cause for war. We were attacked, we can retaliate. Think that's right? You could dig into the history there, it's interesting. There may be more to be said about that. And then 9/11, you know, most people said, well, obvious act of war, we are justified in retaliating. And again, with the Paris attacks. Clear enough on all that? Within war, we're supposed to limit what we do. So again, proportionality within war. Now this means like what's called micro-level proportionality. So if your war aim is to take this city, you can't take the city by killing everyone in the city. That would be disproportional, okay? Connected to this is discrimination, the idea that we should only target those who are legitimately targetable, soldiers, combatants, meaning that civilians and non-combatants should be immune from harm, okay? This is a good kind of discrimination. And then prohibition on intrinsically evil means. No torture, no rape. You know, rape's a useful weapon of war, yeah. Right? If you want to demoralize your enemy, you go in and rape both the men and the women. Can't do that according to this account, right? It would be intrinsically immoral. Here's a nuclear bomb, atomic bomb blast. Interesting question. Case of Japan. They attack Pearl Harbor, right? Seems like we're justified in going to war to fight against Japan. Are we justified in dropping an atomic bomb on Hiroshima and then later on Nagasaki?
Yes.
Yes. Tell me why.
Ended the war.
Ends the war decisively, quickly, right?
I walked across the ruins of Hiroshima.
One could argue it saves lives in the long run. by finishing it quicker, right? Just war theorists have debated this one. It goes multiple ways on this, people thinking about this. The problem, of course, is this, that innocent civilians are killed. Now, notice this about the Second World War. It's worth thinking about. Again, back to how complicated this stuff is. Maybe the war is justified in light of the initial just cause, but something happens later in the war that's not justified. In fact, if you think about war, chances are that's the way it's always going to be, right? There are some justifiable things, there are some noble things, and there are some unjustifiable and ignoble things. It's a complicated human endeavor, right? Interesting set of problems. Okay, just as I mentioned, the just war theory is the mainstream of thinking about this stuff. Interesting historical moment. President Obama wins the Nobel Peace Prize. The Peace Prize. He goes to give his acceptance speech and he says, "We will fight war." There's a little strange irony there. What he says is, in that Nobel Peace Prize speech, is that the just war tradition, the just war theory, is what is going to produce peace in the world. That if we fight justified wars, limited wars, morally appropriate wars, that that's the way that peace is going to be created in the world. That may not be what the Nobel Committee had in mind. Nonetheless, that's the mainstream of thinking about this. American tradition, international tradition, at least in the Western world, the NATO allies and the rest, they want to claim that the way to create global peace is through justified and limited warfare. The war against Syria, the war against ISIS, I guess it's against Syria too.
Sort of,
yeah. The Russians are not fighting against Syria, but we are. Anyway, the consensus seems to be that that war is legitimate and that if we fight it properly and win it, we will create peace. Isn't that the idea? Isn't that the idea? To fight war in order to create peace. The pacifist says, what the hell? I'm pacifist over here. Are you kidding me? We're going to create peace by fighting more war? The pacifist finds that to be insane. And the realist says, hold on a minute. You're going to fight a limited war against an ideological enemy who can never be converted but can only be destroyed? Says the realist. Your moral limits are going to make it such that you never win the war. And in the middle, the just war theorists say, well, we're doing the best we can. It's a problem, right? In fact, there are realists who have argued that this is exactly the problem, that the American military has gone soft because they've become moral. You understand that claim? Let me say it one more time. There are realists who worry that the American military is no longer successful because we've limited ourselves morally, because we refuse to do what we used to do in the bad old days. Okay? The pacifists, meanwhile, say all of that, both just war and realists, have missed the whole point, which is to find active, nonviolent ways to convert the world in the better direction. Right? And again, the realists are over here laughing and saying, you don't get it. History requires us to kill until we win. And so it goes. You've heard this phrase, collateral damage, before, just to tell you how this connects to the just war tradition. It fits in the context of that phrase, discrimination, right? Now, here's the problem for the just war theorists. Some innocent people are killed. We saw the numbers. Right? American planes have killed civilians in the war against ISIS. Is that justifiable? The way to justify it is to appeal to something called the doctrine of double effect or the principle of double effect. It's either a clever moral strategy that makes a lot of sense, or it's moral magic that is bullshit. depending upon your perspective about this, okay? But it works like this. The doctrine of double effect says it's permissible for some innocent people to be killed so long as you don't directly target them. You can foresee that they may be killed as an unintended effect of what you're primarily intending to do. And if the unfortunate thing happens and they end up being killed, you are, in a sense, morally absolved from being responsible for their death because you didn't intend for them to be killed. How does that work? Well, imagine you're a drone pilot trying to kill the bad guy, and you're following him, and as best you can tell, he's in a good place, and you got a clean shot, and you just released the missile or whatever, and a school bus happens to go in the way, and the school bus is destroyed. It's not your fault. You were doing the right thing, trying to kill the bad guy. Why do you need this, if you're a just war theorist? Because you can't control all the circumstances. You can control your intentions, so you ought to intend only to hit the primary target. You know, by the way, that the world includes school buses full of children. You can foresee that sometimes bombs go awry. You can understand that sometimes the intelligence is flawed. You know all of that. But if you have to be perfect about this, you'll never be able to do any of the killing that's required, says the just war theorist. Right? Yeah.
Seems to be a contradiction in terms. How can it be both foreseen and unintended?
Great question.
You're going after one bad guy, and you know with a certainty that there are 129 civilians in that same building. You know for sure that you're going to kill civilians. How can it not be intended?
Great question. So, what? Again, as I said, some people think this is a clever moral argument and others think it's bullshit. So here's the worry, is that what in the hell is the difference between foreseen and intended, right? A little moral magic here, which is that our intentions are what we aim at in terms of the goal of our action, right? So my intention is to destroy this target. What I foresee can be different from what I intend, or not. Again, a matter of how we flesh this all out. Notice how deep now you have to go in terms of moral psychology and sort of what's behind the screen in terms of what our intentions are. One worry I have is about this. Do we ever really know what our intentions really are? I mean, sometimes you're like, screw it. I just want to kill him. I don't care, you know? It's a worry, right? But notice how this is supposed to work from the just war theory standpoint, is moral soldiers are only supposed to intend legitimate targets. And when something goes wrong and someone dies who wasn't intended, in a sense, it's not their fault. Okay? The pacifist says, bull. The pacifist says that when children and innocent people die, this proves that war is wrong. The realist says, who cares? As long as we win. Drones, let's move on towards the end here. War crimes, just a word about Robert McNamara, and I recommend this film, The Fog of War. Anyone seen it? Yeah, for me, the most interesting part of this film, The Fog of War, it's a documentary, Robert S. McNamara, who was the Secretary of Defense, who, you know, basically led us through most of the Vietnam War in the 1960s. McNamara gives an account of what happens in the bombing campaign in the Second World War against Japan. And McNamara, he's also talking about Curtis LeMay, the guy who led the bombers. And McNamara says that if we had lost the war, we would have been accused of war crimes. Flat out says that. Says, we bombed them to smithereens. We firebombed Tokyo. We dropped atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki and so on. Says, McNamara suggests that's probably a war crime, to burn to death a city in a night. But we won. Now the realist says, get it? That's the point. You better damn well win, right? The pacifist says, see, this is the actual problem of war, is that even the winners admit that they've done things wrong, right? The pacifist would reject all of it. And somewhere in the middle, the just war theorist says, we've got to find a way to make sure that the rules of war are adhered to both by ourselves and by our adversaries. right? How are we going to do that? One suggestion is we need to build international institutions that can prosecute war criminals. Problem, of course, is that all of the war crimes prosecutions tend to be pretty one-sided, right? Until there's really an international tribunal that's sort of transnational and treats all these things equally, we're always going to have the realist dynamic, which is you just don't want to get caught, which is why you should win. Okay? All right, give me 2 minutes and I'd love to hear your question and conversation about this. I published a book, it didn't turn out very well, it's called The Just War Myth. Well, just to tell you my view on this. I'm sympathetic to the pacifist. I got a lot of pacifist friends. I like them. But I'm not quite a pacifist. I think the just war tradition is the right approach. But I'm worried that it gets abused and misused. I'm worried that it becomes ideological. I'm worried, frankly, that we say that we always fight just wars and we always win them because we fight them justly. I say that one more time. This is my idea about this. We tell ourselves that we always fight just wars and that we always win them because we fight them justly. And I think that's just not true. Nor do I think it's true that if you fight a just war, you'll necessarily win it, which is problematic. The realist, you hear the realist on my shoulder saying, oh, just war theorists, that means you're not going to win. Now, this is a difficult position. It might be that to be moral, you can't win in a war. Maybe. It's worth considering that. So now we got to think, how important is it either to win or to be just and good? That's a tough one. But I do, you know, I argue in the book with some evidence that when we start telling ourselves this mythic vision of how the just war works, it actually allows us to fight more wars that are not just. Interesting wrinkle of ideology. Most of you probably disagree with me about that. The solution? Education. Citizenship empowerment. We need to have more and better conversations about these things. I would love to see this, that every high school student is introduced to the just war theory. I would love to see that happen, right? To get every American thinking about how important this stuff is. That would allow us to be better in terms of our democratic deliberation and voting for people. It would help us better to understand what service people are doing when they go to fight, right? It would help us to keep our politicians honest about this. But notice, back to sort of where we started with our culture of violence and so on. Is there a video game that includes just war ethics? Think about the culture that our children live in. They go into video land, they listen to rap music and heavy metal. There is no moral story in any of that. It's just about victory and killing, right? It's the realist view. It's no wonder then, I think, that occasionally some whacked out young man picks up a gun and walks into a shopping mall, right? The solution, I mean, if there's gonna be a solution, it has to be something like education. So we've reached the end, and let me just give you my offer of hope, and I'd love to have some questions. Is, you know, this kind of discussion, we need to have a lot more of it in our culture. And we're not good at it. So our emotions run high on all this stuff. And I think if we had better ethics education, more models in civil discourse, and more curiosity, compassion, and courage, we'd do a lot better off. So any thought? We have 10 minutes. We can argue. Yes.
When you mentioned the just war and civilian casualties, I had just heard today that the reason we haven't been bombing the oil is because civilians drive the oil tankers. I don't know how I feel about that, because it seems like he's taking a risk by saying, I'll drive.
Yeah. So she says, probably, you know, one story is, let's cut off the oil supply of ISIS, right? Let's starve them so we prevent them from exporting oil. But the problem is, you say, civilians are involved in the oil infrastructure. So civilians are driving the tankers and maintaining the wells and whatever else. So it would seem to violate just war principles to attack those civilians. That's an interesting problem. Here's one interesting question. Who is a civilian and who's not a civilian? The just war theorists, I mean, I've been to conferences where that's the whole conversation for 3 days straight, and nobody knows the answer to this. Here's the problem. Farmers who grow the crops that feed the soldiers, are they part of the military machine? The bus drivers who drive the troops to the camp where they do their training, are they part of it? The mothers who write them supportive letters, dear son, fight harder. Are they part? How do we draw the line there? It's a tough question. On the one hand, most just war theorists would say there's some pretty obvious lines to draw, right? Children, they're not involved in this, right? The disabled, the very old, right? There are some people who are clearly not combatants. Now, those guys driving the oil tankers, they're interesting middle ground there. It's a tough question. Let's see. In the middle, you didn't have a chance. Yes?
To piggyback off of her thing regarding oil, is that also the same oil that we're importing?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Big, big, big problem. This global war that we've been engaged in for 25 years or so, right? It is connected to all kinds of other issues about the global economy, about geopolitics, about who's friends with whom. I'm sure you've thought this. I mean, Saudi Arabia is a key to all of this. So is Israel. And so our relations with Saudi Arabia and Israel are clearly important in all of this. And the oil economy, we all benefit from it, and so on. I mean, if we're going to solve this, think of all these rabbit holes we got to spin down to figure out who's our friend, who's our enemy, how do we sustain our way of life? Can we sustain our way of life? How about this? Maybe in order to sustain our way of life, we need to continue to engage in these kind of wars because that keeps the global system working, however it's working right now. Maybe. What a sad story. Someone else had their hand up. Yeah, back here, and then you. Yeah.
How can you say children, exempt children, when a seven-year-old has a gun and is shooting someone?
Yeah.
Or the seven-year-old has a mine strapped to its body?
Again, how do we draw the line then? I mean, even the obvious sort of line may not be the line, right? Notice again with terms of the continuum. The realist will say, see, that's why we just don't bother. Because if we don't kill that seven-year-old now, he'll grow up to be a 12-year-old who has a gun. We kill them all now, we rebuild their social structure, and then they become our friend. That's the realist view. The pacifist says, oh my God, you're talking about killing seven-year-olds. And in the middle, somehow the just war theorist has got to find a line that fits and works, and it's not easy. Yes?
What do you see as the, I think a problem for my age group a lot is the postmodernist kind of ethical tradition that a lot of people are taught at universities now, that you can't make a hard and fast moral decision on really much at all.
Yeah.
How would you go about combating that with kind of ethical instruction?
Yeah, so when he walked in, he said he's over 50. He snuck in. He snuck into the ethics class.
Our ages add them together, divide by two, we're over 50.
The interesting, I mean, that's a really important question, sort of to go back to the problem of ethics in general. Notice already, just within war, there are rival, unreconcilable views, right? The realist and the pacifist will not agree about much. This could be a huge, huge problem for ethics. I mean, really, at the end of the day, maybe it's just all like that. Some people have this view, other people have that view. They will never agree. And in fact, the realists will kill the pacifists, and the pacifists will go to heaven and pray that the realists go to hell. I mean, maybe there's no way to resolve any of this. This is what you're saying, the postmodern worry, the relativist problem. Seems to me that even the realist, the pacifist, and the just war theorist can have a conversation about, like, the question of the seven-year-old, right? And the pacifist can understand what the realist says, even though they don't agree. Now, that to me is already a sign of hope, because we can have discourse and deliberation and we can make sense to one another. We may not agree about everything, but at least we probably agree about the ground rules of let's have an argument and present our case. Isn't that cute of me to say that? Meanwhile, what do we do when someone walks in from the back of the room and says, freedom of expression, screw philosophical discourse, down with rationality, I want to kill all of you because I'm not even going to give you a reason, and they open fire on us. I'm sorry for my language there. But I mean, it's that visceral, right? I mean, my presumption is that we're all reasonable of some sort, and that even the pacifist, the realist, can have a conversation. We'll disagree, but we're having a conversation. There are some people who do not want to converse.
That's
right.
ISIS.
ISIS. Yeah. The realist says, see? Those people that don't want to converse, you have no choice but to kill them. Right? Oh, the pacifist will say, well, maybe we could teach them better. How do we do that? I don't know. It's a tough question. Someone else had their hand up here? Yes, over here, you didn't get a chance.
Well, I can't help but think about subject A, the violence and the guy coming in, and this whole war thing. And I really have a full, I'm over 50, but young over 50. And, you know, my kids are just grown, you know, middle-aged adults. And I look at their peers and I see these young people who aren't invested in by their country. And yet, as a culture, we're invested everywhere else in the world. We don't invest in our own kids. They have way too many resources and no direction. And they're out doing these violent things, and we're out doing violent things. And I just wonder where investment should be.
Yeah. You know, my answer would be in education and school.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
And these kids are not being invested in appropriately.
Yeah.
And they're lost. And they're violent, like kids always have been. But now they have all this means because their parents had a lot of means.
Yeah.
I mean,
the social structure, the economic structure, the educational traditions, there's so many issues that are so complicated. Here's one hint of a solution that I don't really like. But it's strange because I said I'm close to the pacifist side. But if we had military service that was required of all citizens, I think that would be part of a solution. Now, I really am strangely not in favor of that, but also in favor of it. But here's why I'm in favor of it, is that nobody gets it, that those numbers of people who are dying, those are people just like you. They're your brothers and cousins and sisters, right? If you don't have any skin in the game, to use that phrase, then you're not going to care, right? And we eliminated conscription in the 1970s, right? And there's some interesting chronology after that in terms of disengagement, in terms of lack of political interest. I mean, think back to the 60s and the anti-war protests. The reason they were protesting is they might have to go fight, right? Doesn't work that way anymore. Now, I have an interesting theory about this, if you have 1 minute to bear with me. It might be that the powers in charge would prefer that we don't have all those protests, so they'd rather hire a mercenary army to fight for us than to ask for a citizen army to do the fighting. And the reason I use that word mercenary is, if you don't know this, it's an interesting fact about the American military. Non-citizens sign up to serve and defend our Constitution and flag. We pay them, and it's a path to citizenship. I don't know if you know this, but there are non-citizens serving in the military. That, by definition, is a mercenary force. We hire professionals to do it, right? It's not a citizen army, in a sense. Now again, I'm strangely ambivalent about that, because I would prefer that there were fewer wars. But maybe there would be fewer wars if more of us were forced to think more carefully about it, you know? One more question?
It's not really a question, but it's more of a positive note. What I have noticed, because we just had Veterans Day, and I have noticed that the teachers, because my husband was doing Vietnam era serve and got a nice letter from our granddaughter. And what I've noticed is that teachers are really emphasizing to the young children about veterans and what they've done for us, because back then everyone did serve. And now, you're right, kids don't have any relationship to any of that. But I'm very proud of the teachers in the classroom that seem, because last year our grandson did something for my husband. They're making them aware that there was sacrifice.
And you're right, we do have commemorations and remembrances and statues and, you know, memorials and so on. And children are being taught about it. It is kind of a good thing.
Yeah.
You know? This is the last bit of a worry is, again, if you're not personally invested in it, if you're never going to fight in a war, it's easy to say, yay for all the war fighters, go fight more wars. You know? This is part of the myth that I talk about, that the way the myth works is it's easier for us to cheer on from the side than to actually have to do it, you know? I think that's a problem. Okay, your ride is here. Denny's in the back. He's saying we're done. Thank you. Have a good Thanksgiving.